Good morning. Welcome to Long Live Alternative Parties Podcast. Free Press Media Press, Inc., an Alternative Parties Books Publisher, sponsors this podcast. I'm Andrew Bouchard.
This call is now being recorded.
Welcome to the Long Live Alternative Parties Podcast. Today, friends, we have another exciting guest on this podcast, like we always do. He is from a nonpartisan reform organization, and we love nonpartisan reform organizations here because they present awesome possibilities to reform and transform the duopoly into something that everyone in the nation can benefit from. So I'm going to have this individual introduce himself and his organization. His name is Patrick Rosensteel. So welcome to the podcast, yeah. Patrick.
Yeah, no, appreciate it, Andrew. Thanks for having me. Yeah, Patrick Rosensteel. I'm with National Popular Vote, Conservatives with National Popular Vote. Launch Libertarians for National Popular Vote. So, definitely understand the value of nonpartisan reforms and what they can do to improve our politics and government. And certainly appreciate people of all political parties and persuasions, and just grateful for the opportunity to be on your show.
Sure. We are looking forward to hearing all about those groups and what they stand for. So kindly give us an introduction to yourself, a brief biographical sketch.
Oh, sure. Well, I live in St. Paul, Minnesota, grew up in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, grew up in American politics. My first jobs were running political campaigns around the country. So I'm kind of a person who's familiar with the way we elect people to Congress and the White House and city councils and mayors and all those kinds of things. So my background was in American politics. I hung up my cleats there maybe about 2000. I'm kind of in the, agency world today, sort of strategic communications, advertising. We get involved in passion projects we care about. And that's what attracted me to a National Popular Vote for president. Which forced me to learn about National Popular Vote and that organization. And, started this project in about 2007. I joined a year after they started moving the plan to have a National Popular Vote for president. I started getting my shoulder to the wheel in 2007 and have been involved ever since. In the trenches, going state by state to make sure we change the system we use for electing the president of the United States from the current state-based winner-take-all system to one where we guarantee the presidency to the candidate who wins the most popular votes in all 50 states in the District of Columbia. And the reason I think that's important is because the candidate with the most votes should win.
Sure.
And more importantly, or as important, we need to figure out a way to make every voter in every state politically relevant when we elect the president of the United States. And in my estimation, there's only one way to do it, and it's the plan at nationalpopularvote.com.
All right. Awesome stuff. Among other things I'd like to hear, and we talked about this before we recorded on the podcast, Patrick is from lives in an area I lived in for a large part of my life, the Twin Cities. So he knows a good place. I loved living there. Pretty much everything but the weather was great over there. So you came from a good place. You live in a good place, Patrick.
Well, you know what they say about Minnesota. If you don't like the weather, come back tomorrow.
Sure.
It can change here in some of the most beautiful seasons. So I didn't know we miss you. We missed you, but we miss you. And hopefully you'll come back and visit.
Yes. Yes, and time is right. That sounds like a plan. So you've mentioned a lot of interesting stuff in your thing about the reforms. Now, you mentioned that you started organizations, Conservatives for National Popular Votes?
Yep.
And then Libertarians as well.
Yeah, that's right. There's a couple of organizations. So our flagship organization is National Popular Vote. And then a couple of organizations that support our effort are Conservatives for National Popular Vote, because we have been and continue to be sort of a movement of conservatives, liberals, moderates, Republicans, Democrats, independents, libertarians, Green Party folks, who just want a better system for electing the president of the United States. We think that when battleground state voters make all the decisions for the American people, it really gets dangerous for the political culture. And I don't know that I've ever run into anybody in all my travels that thinks the current system is working well. Maybe they support it because it's the system we've had. But I don't think there's anybody who believes we got a great politics in America right now. So Conservatives for National Popular Vote is a conservative organization that, you know, I started along with other conservatives, guys like Saul Alinsky, Dennis Lennox, Kent Kaiser, Michael Steele. You know, there are many conservatives that support a National Popular Vote for president. And so that's a supportive organization to National Popular Vote. And then Libertarians for National Popular Vote was stood up by a guy named Ed Lopez, a great guy. And, you know, we put together a steering committee and a steering board. It includes Gary Johnson and
wow.
Pinkin Chafee, you know, Kevin Martin, people who are big players in the libertarian movement that think we should elect the president by national popular vote. And so we all work together and we all coordinate. To make sure that people understand that, you know, we're a multi-partisan sort of movement to fix a non-partisan problem,
sure.
and deliver a non-partisan promise, right? Which is, you know, every voter, no matter what state you live in, should be relevant when we elect the president of the United States, and we all believe that National Popular Vote delivers that.
Sounds good. So. The Electoral College is the crux of the issue here because it's the way we're elected, and that's why the national popular vote is not in place for our country. And from what I understand, people from other countries, it baffles them, and they don't understand how it works. It's a confusing mechanism. So would you please describe briefly the Electoral College and the problems that it represents? And how a national popular vote is going to solve those problems.
Sure. So a couple of things that I think I want to say is the Electoral College is probably the most misunderstood institution in America.
Wow.
So the Electoral College is the power of the state to award electors, right? So if you open up Article 2, Section 1 of the Constitution and you read it, it says that each state shall appoint in such manner as the legislature thereof may direct a number of electors. So the Electoral College is there for the state legislature to determine how they're going to award electors. Okay. We don't have to get rid of the Electoral College to have a national popular vote for president.
Okay.
Right. So it doesn't require any amendment to the Constitution. What we have is a state-based movement that says to the states, do you want to use that power to come together and award your electors on the basis of who wins the most popular votes in all 50 states and the District of Columbia? Okay.
Uh-huh.
So like we use the power as it exists today to move the country to a national popular vote for president.
Uh-huh.
Now, what national popular vote says is you understand that, you have to win a majority of the electoral votes to be elected president,
yes.
Which is 270 of 538 electors. Okay? So our compact, our agreement amongst the states says, in states with 270 or more electoral votes have our bill in place, those states award their electors in block to the winner of the national popular vote. Now, it may sound a little complicated, but it's not really. It uses the power that exists today for the states to award electors and says when enough states say we want a national popular vote for president, we're going to have one because they have enough electors to guarantee the presidency. And it may sound hard in theory, and there's nothing easy about it, but I'll tell you that 16 states in the District of Columbia have already passed our bill.
Really?
205 electoral votes. So to understand how close we are to having a national popular vote for president is to understand a little bit of math, which is when states with 65 more electoral votes pass our bill, we will have a national popular vote for president.
Oh, my.
And we will fulfill the promise that 65% of American voters say they want, right? Which is a system where we guarantee the presidency to the candidate who wins the national popular vote, and a system where every American voter is treated equally, no matter where they live or what party they belong to, in presidential elections. So I don't really talk about the Electoral College that much, other than to say, because my focus is on having a national popular vote for president. And I know that I don't have to amend the Constitution to do that, because the power exists to do it. Okay. And I know that the will of the states is increasingly moving towards a national popular vote for president, because I know we've gone from zero electoral votes to 205. Right?
Okay.
So we just need states with 65 more electoral votes to give the voters what they want and actually improve our politics in this country, which would be great.
You have a lot of momentum going for this.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, no, this is not a science project. You know what I mean? This is it's probably the single most important reform facing the country, to be honest with you, because I think how we elect the president impacts the most American voters in the American political system more than any other election, right? Just when you think about sort of the grassroots activity around electing a president, or how how it's the kind of the brand standard election, you know, if when states with 65 more electoral votes move this country to a national popular vote, it will do more to increase participation. It'll do more to magnify the individual vote of each American voter. And we won't be thinking about ourselves as red states or blue states. You know what I mean? We'll be electing a president of the United States. And frankly, I think that's vitally important, because the American presidency too often lacks the credibility of the bully pulpit of the most American voters, right?
Uh-huh.
And so what it will do is improve the institutions of government at the same time. So, and it's the one clearly with the most momentum that will make the most impact. You will see a changed politics. And some, in a lot of ways, a change in the way that presidents govern the country, because right now all they think about is what do battleground state voters want.
Okay.
You know what I mean? Right now we've got the presidency getting transactional with battleground state voters, because those are the only voters that matter, right? Those are the only ones that are going to determine the outcome of the election. So I don't know how much I'm guessing your listeners in some ways follow presidential elections, right? And I'm sure you do,
sure.
Andrew.
Course,
but it's
like
the next presidential election will come down to five swing states, right?
Yeah.
It always does. And so what happens there, right, for example, is, you know, we'll be talking a lot about protectionism for battleground state voters in Pennsylvania, because Pennsylvania will be a closely divided battleground state.
Yeah.
Right. And while I think trade policy is important to consider when electing a president, I don't think it should all be about protectionism in a vacuum, for example.
Okay.
Or so we want to right size the political influence of battleground state voters.
Okay. So since our party is, I'm sorry, since our podcast is about alternative parties, do you think this would benefit alternative parties, this national popular vote?
Well, I think of all parties as organizations that represent voters, right?
Okay.
So, for example, the Green Party represents Green Party voters, right? The Libertarian Party represents Libertarian voters. And I think a national popular vote for president is in the best interest of voters, which means it's in the best interest of parties. Okay.
Huh.
So, you know, Ralph Nader, who I think continues to associate with the Green Party, Ralph Nader is a huge supporter of a national popular vote for president.
Yeah.
And supports the national popular vote interstate compact. Gary Johnson and Lincoln Chafee, two candidates who ran for president as libertarian, support a national popular vote for president. Presumably, that's because it allows them an opportunity to seek more votes in more states, right? Not just the battleground states.
Okay.
And presumably, it allows them to build stronger parties in all 50 states and or, you know, work with the major parties to adopt platform planks or any of these other kinds of ways that third parties impact our American political system. So, you know, in the end, I think what's in the best interest of voters is in the best interest of all parties, including what I will call third, fourth, and fifth parties.
Oh, okay. Okay. Sounds good. We'll have to hear that when the reforms are going to help us. So what are some misgivings that people have about the national popular vote, and how would you counter their misgivings?
Well, I think stated misgivings are a little bit different than their actual misgivings. A good example of this, I think the major misgiving about any kind of reform, whether it's ours or any other reform, is change, right?
Sure.
And like as a conservative guy, right, conservatives for national popular vote, I don't like change, and I don't like change for change's sake. Okay. But my counter to that for me was, okay, this is a change worth making, right? The current system is crushing under its own weight. The truth is 80% of American voters are ignored in the general election campaign for president of the United States. When 80% of the voters are ignored, and 20% of the voters live in battleground states, that how those states go determine the outcome of elections. Now, we have a system right now where a battleground state judge is likely to determine who the next president is way more than any single voter. You know, then it's like, well, hang on a second. And then when the judge decides, at least 50% of the country believes it's illegitimate, right?
Yeah.
And if he goes the other way, the other 50% of the country will believe it's illegitimate. And what it's doing is lending to this toxic political culture, right, where we're losing faith in the basic institutions we use to govern ourselves.
Sure.
I don't think it's an overstatement to say the system we use to elect the president of the United States is the driving force behind that toxicity or the underlying cause of that tribalism and partisanship, right? And so... Like, I think a major misgiving that I had was, look, this is change, right? And is the change necessary? The current system we have that we've been using since just before the Civil War, right? Like, a majority of states didn't even have the state-based winner-take-all law until the 11th presidential election.
Oh,
the state-by-state system was adopted by the North and the South in the lead-up to the Civil War so it can consolidate the political power of the leading parties of the individual state so they could deliver electors, right? Well, I can't say that I believe it's been working well for the last 200 years. I certainly don't think it's been working well for the last 30, right, where we have divergent elections, where people are losing faith in the American political system and the very institutions that govern us, right? I think that's true if you look at any polling. But faith is eroding in the American political system. And I think it's because we don't apply the principle of one person, one vote to presidential elections.
Huh.
So at heart, national popular vote is a pretty simple fix, right? Do you think the candidate who wins the most popular votes should be elected president of the United States, yes or no? If you think the answer to that question is yes, well, there's one way to get it, which is the planet nationalpopularvote.com, right?
Sure.
And then the other voting question on this, or at least the volunteer question on it to talk to the people who can vote for the national popular vote, is do you think every voter in every state and every political party should have an equal voice in presidential elections, no matter what state they live in? It doesn't sound like very controversial ideas to me. Right?
Sure. You're right.
So if you're yes to both of those questions, it's like, get on board, help us out, call your legislator. Don't call Congress. They can't make this change. It's up to the state legislatures themselves to join the National Popular Vote Interstate Compact so we can have a national popular vote for president.
So you're mentioning how you believe this came, the system started to crumble based on in the, during, around the Civil War time. So would you say that the founders would approve of your reform?
Yeah, I don't know how deep you want me to go into this, but at the Constitutional Convention, the founders had a bunch of votes, right? 22 votes over, like several votes over 22 days to try to determine how we're going to select president, right? They talked about would Congress pick a president. They didn't want that to happen. They didn't think the Congress should have that kind of power over the president. They had votes. So what they determined to do was have an electoral college, and then they set off a series of votes about how those electors would work, right? So or who would select the electors. And they thought maybe the governor, like there was a vote on whether or not the governors would appoint a cabinet that would select electors, and that failed. Whether the legislature would select electors, and that failed. Whether we would have presidential elector districts where you and I would run for electors and white landed men would vote for you or me so that we could decide and vote for president of the United States. All of those ideas failed. So what the founders did is they said, they came up with the language they meant, right? Which is each state shall appoint in such manner as the legislature thereof may direct a number of electors. Because they believe that the legislature was the only body that could provide an effective check on the president, right? That principle of federalism, that the states were going to check president. So what the founders would say is any method the states would use to award electors is consistent with their thinking.
Okay.
So certainly they would support the state power to award electors. Do I believe the founders would support a national popular vote for president? Yeah, I kind of do. And the reason I say that is because I can't think of a scenario under which Jefferson and Madison would want their beloved Virginia to be relegated to flyover status like it is in presidential elections today, right? Or like Hamilton and Adams. I mean, New York and Boston are as irrelevant as any state like North Dakota or South Dakota under the current system because they're reliably Democratic states and nobody campaigns to them in a presidential election. So I think what the founders showed us by moving from sort of a disparate system when they went back and adopted their state statutes to award electors, a lot of them used different methods they voted against. But in the lead up to the Civil War, North and the South, those states started to adopt these state-based winner-take-all laws that we have in place today.
Okay. Right?
So, like, the founders would certainly support any effort to make a Virginian more relevant in presidential elections than they are today.
Sure.
Right? They changed from one system to another in the lead-up to the Civil War. And I think that any Virginian should want Virginia voters to be as relevant as a battleground state voter, say, in Florida.
Yes.
Right. So sure. Philosophically, as a philosophical conservative and somebody who understands sort of, the Constitutional Convention, read the minutes, understands what they were going for here, it's no doubt to me that the founders would embrace this compact. Now, I can't speak for them, obviously. They're not here to defend themselves or disagree.
Sure. Fair enough. So it sounds like it's a reform in one sense, yet in another sense, it's going back to what the founders intended. So it is conservative in that sense.
I think it preserves the power of the legislature to award electors and doesn't amend the Constitution because it doesn't need to.
Sure.
Like the founders wouldn't. So, and the reason we know it doesn't require a constitutional amendment to change the way a state awards electors is because Maine and Nebraska do it differently than 48 other states, right?
Oh.
They have a congressional district bill where they award an elector. We didn't hold a constitutional convention to allow Maine and Nebraska to do that. Maine and Nebraska simply changed their state law, which it's their power and exclusive power to do. Sure. The Commonwealth of Massachusetts has had 13 different methods with which they have awarded electors.
Wow, that's
a lot. We didn't have a constitutional convention every time that happened. So I think what the founders would say is, indeed, this is the intended use of the power under Article 2, Section 1, which is for states to do what they believe is in the best interest of their country, their state. And there isn't any question that I believe that a national popular vote for president is in the best interest of my home state of Minnesota. And I say that as a conservative Republican who's trapped behind the blue wall in the only state that voted for Walter Mondale, right? Huh. Like, I could have stayed home in every presidential election. So I think the founders would appreciate the approach. I think the founders would do what's in the best interest of their state. And when 80% of the voters in roughly 80% of the states are ignored under the current system, I think the founders would expect those states to use their power to make their states more relevant, which is what a national popular vote for president does.
Sure. So I take it that when the states have passed these laws, they succeeded versus any legal challenges in the courts.
Oh, for sure. So the way I answer this question is, look, this is America. When the National Popular Vote Interstate Compact takes effect, right? Remember, it takes 270 electoral votes for it to take effect. When it takes effect, this is America. There will be a lawsuit. We will win the lawsuit. There is no more clear case law, frankly, in the country than the exclusive power of the state to award electors.
Really?
Cool case, if any of your listeners are lawyers, they can go look at the most recent one, which is the Schiaffalo case in Colorado, where the state of Colorado was sued over their what's called a faithless elector law. Well, the Supreme Court of the United States said what Colorado does to bind its electors is Colorado's decision. It's totally up to Colorado. Or when small states led by North Dakota, for example, sued the state of New York over their state-based winner-take-all law back when New York was a battleground state, the court told all those small states pound sand because what New York does with their electoral votes is up to New York. So the idea that states can award electors is like beyond settled, right? And it's because, especially with a conservative court that has a strict interpretation, but I think any court, obviously, they're going to read the Constitution and say, yeah, of course there's the legislative power to award electors. To the extent the court will decide anything is whether or not the National Popular Vote Interstate Compact requires congressional consent. Now, courts don't decide that until you reach the triggering threshold, in this case, 270 electoral votes, at which point the court will say either you don't have to go get congressional consent, and there's a long story around that that isn't important. It's probably really important, but maybe not that interesting. Current case law says that interstate compacts that do not encroach on what's called federal supremacy do not require the consent of Congress. Well, in this case, there isn't even a federal power, let alone supremacy. So under current case law, this is the kind of compact that wouldn't require consent. The court might say Article 1, Section 10 of the Constitution says no state shall enter into a compact without consent of Congress, at which point you go get consent from Congress. And that's how congressional consent works. But that's the only real legal question that's open, is whether or not this compact would require consent. And if we have 270 electoral votes in the compact, we'll go get congressional consent if the court determines we need to, and we'll get it. And the compact will take effect, and we'll have a national popular vote for president.
So, Patrick, how does national popular vote get its message to the American people? What's your approach to attracting people to the cause and informing people about the cause?
Yeah, it's a great question. Our audience are the legislatures in the states, but what's important is our customer's customer, which is the voters, right? Sure. And so getting a message out is always important in cases like this. And how do we do it? We do it in every way possible, right? We work the legislature through lobby activities, right? We educate people on the movement by doing podcasts like this and television and radio and print interviews in pretty much every paper, on the planet and many of the shows. I think 2024, while we're electing the next president, there's always an uptick in interest in our national popular vote movement.
Okay.
And so we take full advantage of that through free media and earned media and being subject matter experts on an important issue. We have a huge email list. So, I mean, if you like what you're hearing me say today and believe we should have a national popular vote for president, best thing you can do is go to nationalpopularvote.com and then hit the right legislator button, and then you become a part of our email network, where we send newsletters, and then we engage people to talk to their neighbors, to weigh in with their elected officials. There are any number of ways we educate, sort of the universe on this issue. And what I know for sure is, it's really easy to educate people when there's a divergent election, right? That's what they call them in political science. When the candidate with the most votes doesn't win the presidency, or the candidate with the least number of popular votes is elected president. You know what I mean? Like, I got the biggest news story on the planet, maybe one or two of them. I'm one of the top two on those days. So we're just grateful anytime people like you reach out, where you have a microphone and you have an audience. Because we don't, look, I think, I love to be able to educate people that this isn't a theory, this is a movement, that this is a movement that can and is going to happen if everybody supports a national popular vote for president, puts their shoulder to the wheel and uses their voice. So, we like to talk to people with microphones because they have audiences. And, there aren't a lot of American people who, when you shine a little bit of light on this current system, say, you know what, it's working really well. So we hope your listenership will get involved, and or at least the ones that agree with us. And frankly, the ones who disagree with us should weigh in, too. If you think the current system's working, if you think 20% of the country should make decisions for 80% of the country when it comes to electing the president of the United States, you should probably let your elected officials know. But in the end, if you believe every voter in every state should be politically relevant, if you think a reinvigorated grassroots politics in all 50 states is the answer to most of our problems, right, then you should probably get on board with us and get your shoulder to the wheel and help us out. Because when I started this project, it's like, this is going to be really cool if it happens. Now it's just a matter of time. Now it's when it happens. Because, we got 16 states in the District of Columbia that have passed our bill with 205 electoral votes. We've also passed one chamber or another, the House or both, House or the Senate, in 8 additional states with 78 electoral votes, which is more than the 65 required. So it's also a pivotal time. It's also a tipping point for this campaign. And I hope everybody who thinks we should elect the president by national popular vote gets smart, gets educated, gets involved, gets mobilized through our website so we can get this project done for the American people.
Perfect. So what is the website again? Exact address?
Nationalpopularvote.com is sort of the best, spoke. It's the best place to get the most information, most informed, and write your legislator. Conservatives for national popular vote, libertarian for national popular vote. Those are good ways to get involved if you're one of those two. But, I would say the most information, and it's an information portal, is at nationalpopularvote.com. But come find us any way you can find us, and we'd welcome you to the movement.
Excellent. Patrick, we thank you for coming on the podcast today and talking about your movement that has a lot of momentum behind it, it sounds like.
I appreciate your interest and your time. And if you want to do it again, just let me know.
Excellent. We wish you all the best in this campaign and everything else you do in your personal professional life.
Awesome. Thank you, Andrew.
Take care and all the best.